So let me welcome you to this fourth lecture in this series that we've been doing over the course of the year, Philosophers in the Middle of History. And we started out in the ancient period with Aristotle and then moved through, and now we're in the 20th century with the great philosopher Hannah Arendt, who didn't like to call herself a philosopher. That actually happens with a lot of philosophy people. She preferred to think of herself as a political theorist, so we'll talk about why in a moment. Before we actually get started, I'm really happy to say that we're renewed for another four lectures here at the Frank Weinberg Library, and we'll be doing, in the spring, we'll be doing the ancient period, with talking about Plato and locating him in his times, and I'll talk about how he got captured by a tyrant, for example. We'll talk about this guy Boethius, who actually also got captured by a tyrant and ends up getting executed, unfortunately, as the modern the medieval philosopher. Thomas Hobbes, the guy who wrote Leviathan, we'll talk about him, his times, you know, the English Civil War, the Armada, all this great stuff for the early modern period, and then we'll hit on Friedrich Nietzsche for the last lecture of the year. So there's a lot coming up. Hannah Arendt is a philosopher who not only is right smack dab in the middle of 20th century history and deeply formed by it, but who, unlike the other philosophers that we've looked at before, winds up being somebody who thinks a lot about the nature of history and what it means to live historically or to think historically. So she really provides a sort of an embarrassment of riches if you look at her works. I only brought along a few of them, but she really wrote quite a number of brilliant works. And we're going to concentrate mostly on certain features, because it's impossible to cover all of the main points of her philosophy in about an hour and a half lecture and discussion. So, like the title of the talk says, it's Hannah Arendt, Totalitarianism, and the Holocaust. But the way that she looked at, on the one hand, totalitarianism as a sort of new thing in the 20th century, and the Holocaust ends up, you know, bleeding over into all sorts of other things as well. And so it really has a lot to do, I think, even with our current historical situation that we're living in now. So what I try to do in these lectures is talk a bit about the philosopher and his or her views on things, but also in terms of the history that they lived in. So when it was Aristotle, I talked a lot about Alexander the Great, for example, and how their relationship, which wasn't very good, worked out. It actually worked out quite well with Alexander being very far away from Aristotle. So what we're going to talk about Arendt and her life and her thought in the context of the 20th century, which she thought of as a radical rupture with the past. And she thought there was a great danger in this that we had to face up to, but also that we couldn't pretend like, you know, there was some sort of easy continuity going from, you know, the medieval period or the early modern period into the 20th century. She thinks things went really off the rails in many respects. So what I'm going to talk about first is a bit of intellectual biography, you know, locating her in her times. And then I want to hit on what we call philosophical anthropology, which means the study of the human person, the human nature, and what she thought about that, and how that fits in with living historically, being informed historically. And then we'll look directly at totalitarianism and her discussions of that. You know, the most famous work she has, I think that more people have read than her other works is Eichmann in Jerusalem. You know, it's about the trial of Eichmann, who was instrumental in the Holocaust. He was a really central figure. But she also has a book, The Origins of Totalitarianism, specifically about how all of that developed. So I want to talk about that and the Eichmann trial. And then I don't have a lot of, and you'll see why, really well thought out views on exactly what Hannah Arendt thinks we ought to be doing in the present in terms of reconstructing a viable way of living together and thinking together. She didn't really think that she had something that was a program that people could latch on to. But we'll talk about what she has to say about that. In these lectures, they usually end up being, and I like it this way, discussions rather than just straight lectures. So I always reserve some time at the end for, you know, some just general discussion and Q&A, but you should feel free at any point to ask questions or, you know, raise comments or say, oh, I think she's totally wrong about that, or, you know, she's on track about this, or it reminds me of that. I been giving lectures about this sort of stuff and other things for probably the last 15 years, so I'm very good at getting things back on track if they go off on a tangent. And I think that's part of what makes doing this sort of discussion very, very interesting and fun. And I think it really fits in well with the theme of Arendt, which ties in with her views on how things work out through discussion, through back and forth, through what she called plurality. She didn't insist on single viewpoint. I don't actually know much about how she ran her classes. She did, in fact, teach here and there, and she was, you know, invited to be a professor at different places. I would suspect that, she came up in a traditional German educational setting, so I don't know how, intense that emphasis was on, you know, the lectures, the students listen, or anything like that. I like to think that she probably promoted quite a bit of discussion. So let's talk first about her life and where she fits in. The timeline, which is actually on like the third page of the handout packet that we've got, I put three things side by side. Hannah Arendt herself, her life, totalitarian society, and the Jewish community. There's a lot of spillover back and forth between those. You notice that one of the things that is really straddling the 20th century is what we call the Dreyfus Affair. And I'm going to assume that not everybody's familiar with this, so if you already know all about this, you just have to pardon me. Dreyfus was a military officer in France, and there were some plans, the French plans. There were a lot of tensions between Germany and France and a lot of other countries at the time. And some of the French war plans got passed on to the Germans. Dreyfus didn't do it. Another guy did it. And we're pretty sure that he did it historically. But Dreyfus was the fall guy. And he was the fall guy because, in large part, because he was Jewish. And what ended up happening was people staked out positions. You know how when you've got fault lines within a society or a country, sometimes it takes a catalyzing event for people to start filtering out and say, I'm on this side or I'm on this side. And when that happens quite often, the people on this side, those other people are totally, screwed up. They have no conception of things, or they're, trying to take advantage of this for their own purposes, to push their own agenda, but the other side's saying exactly the same thing. And you get what's called factionalization. That's what happened in French society. And because France was so important culturally in Europe, it sent up shockwaves going throughout the rest of Europe. And so, how did people line up? Well, you had, the Catholic Church, or at least, the very conservative elements within it, the army, some of the other institutions of French life lining up on one side. You had the more progressive elements lining up on another side, and both of them really going at each other for quite a while. Action Française, which is one of the, you could call it a proto-fascist organization. They're one of the first people to have what you could call stormtroopers. They call them the Camelot Noir, the sort of fighters for the king. They emerged from that context. And it sets up a lot of stuff. And you notice that Arendt is born around the time that the Dreyfus affair finally gets resolved. It tears apart French society for a while. You notice another important event that comes out of that. You can't really tell from this handout. The Protocols of the Elders of Zion is actually essentially a plagiarized piece built off of an imaginary dialogue between Machiavelli and Montesquieu in hell. And it goes through a couple transformations, and suddenly it becomes this document in the hands of some Russian secret police agents in Paris. It becomes what we now know as the Protocols of the Elder of Zion. It winds up in Russia, and it starts appearing publicly the year before Hannah Arendt is born. And that document, which is very easy to demonstrate, that it's essentially just cutting and pasting stuff and changing names around, has a huge effect. People believe that it's a real document. They draw conclusions from it. Anti-Semitism had been around for quite a while, but it takes on different forms as we move into the 20th century. You notice with Arendt, she's born in Germany, in Hanover. Her family moves to Königsberg, which at that time, right now it's actually in the news. It's not called Königsberg anymore. Does anyone know what it's called now?
Kaliningrad.
Yeah, exactly. And it used to be that little part of Germany that was kind of off on its own. When the Soviets came through, they appropriated that. Now it's part of Russia. And so it's in the news quite a bit because there's quite a bit of tensions. And there's things getting staged there. So she ends up living there. Her father dies pretty young and pretty early in her life. And the year that her father dies, World War One starts. And we tend to think of World War One in the Western perspective, in terms of the Western powers and Russia over there against those Axis powers, the democracies against the oligarchical, whatever you want to call them, non-democratic forces, the German Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Very different experience on the Eastern Front. The Eastern Front was chaos. You have Russian armies coming in, and you have the German armies squaring off against them. Then further south, you have the Austrian armies, and the Austrians and the Russians both managed to bollocks things up pretty well. The Russians, and the Germans are clashing in the area where these people are living, and the Russians end up getting pushed back. They're not equipped for fighting. But you notice that as the Russian forces are retreating, hundreds of thousands of Jews are forced out of the areas where they're living by the retreating soldiers. Not long after that, we see World War I resolve, and in the East, how did it resolve? Russia collapses. There's a revolution. And again, there's chaos. Nobody's quite sure what's going to happen. The war is still being fought while the revolution is going on. And eventually the Bolsheviks come to power. They replace the provisional government. And you have this Russian civil war going on in the East between, the Reds, the communists, and the various white forces supported by England in some places, supported by France in other places, actually supported also by the United States. We had troops in the north of Russia at one point during the Russian Civil War. So you see all of this going on. She is growing up with this. And then not too long after that, what happens? We see the rise of the Nazi Party in Germany. And in the 20s, it's really not that strong compared to what it's going to be in the 30s. You notice 1921, Adolf Hitler becomes the Nazi Party's first chairman. Mussolini's fascist government takes over in Italy in 1922. And, when we think of fascism, or if we think a bit you know, more broadly about these various movements. We usually think of Italy and Germany, but if you look at what was going on in the history of European states, democracies were just disappearing. It wasn't just Italy and Germany. Romania has this you know, particularly strong, essentially fascist movement going on. Hungary does as well. Poland, arguably, is under at least a military dictatorship, if not, you know, looking rather fascist itself. You know, when the Allies are supporting Poland, they're not supporting a democracy. They're supporting another state against German aggression. And things actually look pretty dim for what we call liberal democracy, the regime that we kind of take for granted these days, in the late 20s and early 30s in Europe and in other places as well, like South America. So, you know, we see things going on. Arendt herself in the 20s is now, you know, finishing up high school. She goes off to college and she studies at a few different places. And if you look at who she studied with, these were, you know, pretty big names. She studies with Rudolf Bultmann, theologian. She studies very briefly with Edmund Husserl, one of the fathers of phenomenology. And she gets involved with another guy who, you know, is quite infamous, Martin Heidegger. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. She becomes involved with him as a young, arguably starry-eyed student while he's still married, and they have some sort of affairs going on, a few breakups as well. It's kind of dramatic, and it doesn't go on for very long, but it does happen. Then she leaves, and she studies with somebody else who, at that time, was probably as famous as Heidegger. He's probably not as famous now, Karl Jaspers, who is a philosopher and a psychotherapist, really interesting guy. And she does her, as you do when you study, she does a dissertation, and her dissertation is on St. Augustine and the concept of love. It's been translated and published subsequently. She gets married, and she begins working on a book about a woman whose name is Rahel Varnhagen, who is a Jewish, you could call her sort of a, not a socialite so much, somebody who was involved in the interconnection between society and intellectual life. She was Prussian, and she wanted to, you know, build up social life, and you know, intellectual life in Prussia was not particularly well developed at the time in the 19th century. But she was Jewish, she's in Berlin in the early 1800s, and she's trying to build up something. And Arendt is interested in her, in part because she sees in her somebody who she has something in common with. Arendt is Jewish, you know. Although she's coming from essentially a converted family, right? They've left their Judaism behind in large respect. Now, you notice that as things start to heat up in both Germany and in the East, with the Soviet Union on the one hand and Germany, you know, shifting towards Nazism on the other hand, she becomes politically active. And this gets her in trouble, quickly enough, with the Gestapo. And she winds up being imprisoned for a short time. Gets out, gets the hell out of the country. First she, you know, goes down to Switzerland, and then she finally ends up in Paris. And while she's in Paris, you know, what's happening? Well, you have all of these Jews leaving Germany because things are getting worse and worse and worse. And you can see the progression happening on this timeline. The screws are constantly tightening. And I think there was, you know, when you read the memoirs of the time, there was a lot of wishful thinking going on about they can't really mean everything that they're saying about, you know, getting rid of all Jews or sending them to you know, somewhere else, like maybe sending them to Kenya. Rational people don't do that sort of thing. And remember, too, Germany at that time had the reputation for being the, you know, country of philosophy, being the country that was at the leading edge of science, being a rational country. You know, we have sort of a tarnished view because we look back at it through the lens of the Nazi debacle and the Holocaust. But at the time, there were a lot of people thinking, how far could reasonable people let these Nazis go? But many of them were also saying, well, just in case, let's get the hell out of here. And Paris was one of the places that many of them were going, and so Arendt was connected up with that. You know, she loses her German citizenship in 37. She ends up, you know, divorcing her first husband. And you notice during this time, the Munich Agreement is being signed. The Germans are arriving at the very first, you know, final solution, which is they're going to get rid of, they're going to make all of Germany Jew-free. Judenrein was the key word. And they're going to do it by sending them somewhere else. Not, and they actually debated about this. Should it be somewhere in Africa? Well, we're going to take, you know, the German territories that the British took away from us, you know, in World War I. We're going to take those back. We're not going to settle Jews there because German blood was shed for that. Let's send them to Madagascar. We'll take that away from the French, and that'll be the end of the story. It's an island. Don't let anyone off. All of this stuff is being worked out at that time, before World War II begins. And then when World War II begins, it's another thing that's quite interesting. We look back at World War II as being, again, the Axis versus the Allies, right? There's even a cool board game that you can play where it's exactly that, right? But things were a lot more complicated. Nobody quite understood what to make of the Nazi-Soviet pact, the non-aggression pact that they signed. England and France were squaring off again with Poland and hoping they could bring in some of their other allies against Germany and then soon enough Italy. And Russia seemed to be neutral, but the allies actually thought they were going to have to fight Russia too, especially after Russia invades Finland. So the Russians or the Soviets are doing their own thing. You know, the Axis powers are really making a lot of headway, especially after they defeat the French very quickly. Things start looking very grim. Japan is engaged in its own adventure in China and Korea, and then eventually starts getting involved in the United States. And now we have a world war going on. And I think you can say pretty straightforwardly, the Soviets were never really on the Allied side. They were always on their own side. Doing their own thing. And Arendt is focused on all this. She ends up relocating. She manages to get out of France. Before she does, she's actually interned in a camp, which is really far down in the rural area of France near the Pyrenees. And she was going to be sent to an extermination camp if she hadn't escaped. She does escape. She and her husband and mother manage to make it going through Portugal to New York. And that's now she's in the United States after that, except for trips here and there. And you notice that she's in the United States. She begins writing. She starts doing editorial work, really any work that she can find. And things are going worse and worse and worse. Now we're in the middle of the final solution. You know, it didn't happen immediately, but it didn't take very long before these camps, these mass extermination camps, are being formed. And, there's just all this stuff happening in what the Germans called the East. You know, the conquered Eastern European countries, like Poland, and the vast areas of Russia that they've managed to take hold of. These camps, like we know now, because they're still there, like Dachau and Buchenwald and Auschwitz are being built there very quickly. And we're going to talk about Eichmann in a bit. Eichmann was one of the people who's involved in the logistics of making all this happen quickly enough. At the same time, some of the German allies are doing their own anti-Semitic purges. The Hungarians turn over a number of Jews. The Romanians, they were under this essentially fascist regime, were engaged in their own form of anti-Semitism that the Germans thought was quite poorly run, and they didn't interface well with them. But, you know, it shows you what's going on. Arendt starts doing some major writing. This first important book, The Origins of Totalitarianism, comes out in 1951. Of course, when you're doing a work like this, the research that goes into it has been going on for years and years and years. And so she's already doing some of the thinking that's going into this while she's observing what's happening in Nazi Germany, in Soviet Russia, in other places. And you know, she's also responding to what she sees happening on the scene, say, in communist China, what little they could get from that, worrying about what might be happening in India, if India tilts towards totalitarianism. And, you know, you can see book after book after book coming out, and they're all either concerned with sort of doing, again, she said she's not actually a philosopher, she's a political theorist, because she sees everything as tied in with politics, but she writes some books that are some, you know, essentially straight out good philosophy, but from a historically informed perspective. Like one of them, for example, is this unfortunately, she doesn't completely finish before she dies, The Life of the Mind, but it's she gets quite a bit of it done. Some of her stuff is focused on thinking about politics, the 20th century, and what happened. Her book on violence, for example, her book on revolution, because these are key ideas. She writes an essay on Little Rock that we're going to look at a little bit. She also winds up doing a lot of lectures at different places and remains involved with publishing. Arendt is somebody who you can call a public philosopher. And it's kind of nice. There is a Hannah Arendt Center at Bard College in New York. And that's actually where she's, I think, buried. And they're very much about public engagement between philosophy and politics and culture. That's what Arendt thought was absolutely important. I think, in part, she didn't want to be called a philosopher because she didn't want to be seen as merely a theorist, you know, in her office, hiding out from students, writing papers, you know, doing that sort of thing, which, admittedly, a lot of philosophers in the 20th century have been, and arguably, in the 21st century, most of them are still like that, I'd say. She was very publicly engaged, and she attends, for example, the reason why she's got these reflections on Eichmann, she goes to his trial. She manages to snag herself a correspondent job with the New York Times, and, you know, she goes out there, I imagine, on their expense, you know, report, dime, and attends the trial and watches and writes things down. So she's constantly reflecting. And she it's not just about the Holocaust, it's also about the aftermath of that, the creation of the nation of Israel. She's, you know, rather optimistic at some points and also rather critical. Ben-Gurion was a hero to the Israelis. She worries about the Israeli state itself sliding into something like a dictatorship very early on. She doesn't let anybody off the hook when it comes to thinking about what ought to be done and what ought not to be done. There's nobody who gets to wear, you might say, I mean, you guys all remember, you know, the white hat, you know, the old westerns, right? You tell who the good guy is because he wears a white hat, and there's the bad guys with the black hat. And then, of course, Sergio Leone comes in and everybody's got black hats, you know. But before that, there are people who are identifiable as the forces of goodness, the forces of right, the ones who are going to set things straight. Arendt, without trying to, you know, tear things down for their own sake, is very willing to say, no, this is good, but this thing that you're doing is pretty dangerous. This thing you shouldn't be thinking about at all. And she does that with the Israeli state. You notice that she ends up dying in 1975. She has a heart attack first in 1973 on the way to give the Gifford Lectures, which is a huge honor for people in philosophy. It's sort of like winning the Olympics, you could say, to be invited to give the Gifford Lectures. She has a heart attack, unfortunately, and she has another heart attack in 19, 1975. And you notice that The Life of the Mind is published later, posthumously. There's actually quite a few things. She was working on the third volume of this, which has been published as little bits and pieces, but she hadn't quite finished it when that comes out. So that's her life and where it fits in with these massive world events. You can see she's right in the middle of everything. So she's pretty well placed. And she's directly, you might say, existentially concerned. You know, the Holocaust is not something that happened to other people for her. The Holocaust is that could have been her, you know, at that time. So this is a good place to take a little pause before we go into anything more. Any comments or questions or reflections? Anything you want to discuss in particular, or should we jump into?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Who appreciated her work the most, Americans or people in Europe?
Oh, that's a great question. It's interesting because I would say Americans in general have appreciated her work more, although she's invited to give lectures at different places. But it's pretty selective, and in her lifetime, the people who liked Hannah Arendt often liked her for very different reasons and disagreed over those reasons. So she's liked by people on the left in part because she's willing to, say, take Marx seriously, right? And she's willing to say capitalism isn't, you know, super great and there's problems within American society. It's not totalitarian. As a matter of fact, she really was a fan of the American Revolution and American society compared to, say, the French Revolution, right? Which, of course, not going to endear to the French. But, you know, the left sort of, I think they thought that she was on their side because she's saying some of the right things. This happens to a lot of people, right? They're profound thinkers. People, they say some things, and then people are like, yeah, I like that. I resonate with that. And then they find out the other stuff that she's saying. And then they're like, whoa, she must not really mean that stuff, right? So there was that. There were some people on the right who really liked her. Leo Strauss, for example, big fan of Hannah Arendt. Then you know she had a lot of following because she wrote for Jewish publications among fellow Jews. And then there were other Jewish writers later on who were like, she's totally wrong about Eichmann. You know, and in part the origins of totalitarianism. She gets accused of being one of the self-hating Jews by other Jewish people. I think unfairly, because they think that she's quoting anti-Semitic material in some sense approvingly. When I think she's just sort of like presenting the historical record. But so the appreciation of her winds up being kind of selective, you might say. And the people who line up, it's sort of like with party coalitions. You know, if you think about today's Democrats and Republicans. They're coalition parties, which means that there might be somebody who's a Republican because they're just super pro-business and they couldn't care less about social conservatism. And as a matter of fact, they don't even like those people because they're no fun at parties. And then there's other people who are like social conservatives, and they think that the party's going to do this or that, and they'll vote the same way. And then you can say the same thing with Democrats, right? The Democrats are even more heterogeneous mishmash of incompatible elements, right? It's kind of a peculiarity of our system, I think. We do our coalition governing through the two parties rather than having a bunch of parties that have to cobble it together. But Arendt was the same way. So, you know, when I run into people and they say, I like Hannah Arendt, I always want to know, why do you like her? Because it might not be for the same reason I do. So, yeah, that's a great question. Yeah.
Did she like the United Nations concept?
Oh, yes and no. This is where we get to some really interesting stuff. So she really didn't like the UN Declaration on Human Rights. She thought that this talk about human rights was a big mistake, in part because they were going to be so difficult to actually enforce. And she thought if you like raise everybody's expectations by talking about human rights, and you can't actually enforce it, then how is this different than, say, the League of Nations was, right? She does recognize that there needs to be something beyond just the nation state that can produce something like a livable community. One thing that they used to talk about a lot, and they don't talk about this very much anymore, in the early 20th century, and this led to the League of Nations, was the notion of the community of nations, that we could have, it wasn't just about having states, like, you know, we live in the United States, and then there's Canada, and, you know, we've got Mexico to the south, and we're all different in that, you know, we have the president, and we vote this way, and they vote that way. It was understood more like, well, look, you have a nation, and the nation gets to work out its particular character and its particular ways of resolving issues. And the fact that they don't come up with the same solution as what, you know, France or Uganda does isn't a bad thing. There's a kind of diversity among peoples that's a good thing. And insofar as the United Nations could promote that and could, like, say, prevent destructive wars, you know, you think about just how much was lost in not just World War II, but also in World War I. Just how much material, how many human lives. She saw that as a good thing. She also thought the United Nations tended to be, like any organization, it tended to get pushed around a lot by some of its members. Some of the resolutions could be unduly idealistic, unduly pragmatist, you know. So she certainly didn't unqualifiedly endorse it, you know. So it's kind of an interesting contrast to somebody like another public intellectual who talked about the UN was Jacques Maritain, this French Catholic philosopher who played a role in the Declaration of Human Rights. You know, he thought it was a great thing. She thought, look, if you can't actually enforce these rights, why are you talking about them? You know, what we need to think about is rights that can actually, we can put some teeth into. And, you know, you look at some of the genocides, in recent years that people just didn't do anything about, like Rwanda. You know, what did the UN actually accomplish when it came to that? Not much, unfortunately. Reconstruction. It would be interesting to see what she would have said had she lived much longer, you know. So, yeah. So let's talk about politics and history. Some of the quotations that I have here for you come from that. And Arendt thought that, you know, these could be two main themes for her. We, as human beings, if we're going to live well together, this is coming from Aristotle, we need to have politics. That's the realm. It's not just about economics, like making a lot of consumer goods. It's not just about what we call civil society. The political sphere is also important as well. And that's something that we're always, like, you know, jarring against each other. If we have a democracy, people think different things and they argue with each other. Although we have some really great political theories and we often talk as if we've got it all figured out, nobody's got it figured out when it comes to the political life. We're always kind of learning it as we go, which means that the more we do it, if we're actually doing it in a thoughtful way, the better we get at it. And it means we're going to make mistakes. We're going to disenfranchise some people who shouldn't be. We're going to, like, put the bridge in the wrong place sometimes, right? People are going to screw up, and then we can get better at it. She's not the only person to think this way. John Stuart Mill is another person. Alexis de Tocqueville, who she's a big admirer of, who wrote Democracy in America, thinks that was great. What was great about America is people got practice engaging in local politics, as opposed to, like, in places like France, where you're either a bureaucrat or you stayed out of it altogether. So there's that. And then there's this thinking historically, seeing ourselves within a history that we're not reducible to, but also informs what we're doing. So we need to take some account of it. And we got to try to not falsify or idealize history in the process. So if you look at these two first passages, this is from The Human Condition. She talks about the vita activa, that means the active life. And here, again, here's where she differs from a lot of philosophers. Philosophers typically are not about the vita activa, they're about the vita contempliva, you know, the theoretical life, the contemplative life. And she says, I want to designate three fundamental human activities. This is actually from the first page of her book. Labor, work, and action. They're fundamental because each corresponds to one of the basic conditions under which life on Earth has been given to human beings, or man. Labor is the activity which corresponds to the biological process of the human body. You know, the human condition of labor is life itself. This could be taken from Marx, right? She's understanding that labor is something that we do, but it could also be taken from other thinkers like Hegel. Then she says work is the activity which corresponds to the unnaturalness of human existence, which is not embedded in and whose mortality is not compensated by the species' ever-recurring life cycle. Work raises us out of the purely animal of labor. And she says work provides us with an artificial world of things, distinctly different from all natural surroundings. I mean, look at this room, right? This is a product not of just labor, but of work. And she says, within its borders, each individual life is housed, while this world itself is meant to outlast and transcend them all. The human condition of work is worldliness. This is a term that she's taking from Martin Heidegger. Being in the world is not just like, you know, being an isolated individual who just sort of pops into existence and can, you know, think about everything independently. No, it means to be rooted in an environment where, you know, think about the fact that, like, you guys have shirts, I've got a shirt, I'm wearing this tie in part because I'm giving a lecture, you know. Why aren't you guys wearing ties? Why are you so informal? Well, you're not because you're wearing button-down shirts. All of this is, like, part of our world. And all of this is the product of labor to some degree. Then she talks about something even higher, action. The only activity that goes on directly between men without the intermediary of things or matter corresponds to the human condition of plurality, to the fact that men, not man, live on the earth and inhabit the world. And she says, while all aspects of the human condition are somehow related to politics, this plurality is specifically the condition of all political life. Politics is not just the art of the possible, the way people talk about it. It's about how you deal with difference, how you deal with human beings disagreeing with each other. Now, in her reflections on Little Rock, she said some things that are quite interesting. She actually was kind of guarded about desegregation. And what I want to hit on in this, I'm actually going to just summarize it. She wants to distinguish between three different realms. She talks about the political realm, in which ideally we're all equals. We all get a vote, we all get to talk at each other. Now we know in reality some people have more power than others, right? In different ways. But that's one of the things that sort of makes things political. You have the notion that we all have a stake. And then we have society. And society is not actually governed by equality, according to her. Society is a realm of difference and discrimination, where different classes or different groups actually do separate off from each other. And she says, if you try to reduce the one to the other, if you take society and you try to make it totally equal, you politicize it. If you try to take, on the other hand, the political and say, well, you know, things are unequal over here in society, so that's okay over here in politics, you wind up with something that's not really a political sphere. And then in addition to those, we have the private sphere. And what she has to say about that, I'll actually read that, because this is kind of interesting to look at. She says, the realm of privacy is ruled neither by equality nor discrimination, but by exclusiveness. There's a third value there. Here we choose those with whom we wish to spend our lives, personal friends and those we love. And our choice is not guided by likeness or quality shared by a group of people. It's not guided by any objective standards or rules, but strikes inexplicably and unerringly at one person in his uniqueness, in likeness to all other people we know. The rules of uniqueness and exclusiveness are and always will be in conflict with standards of society because social discrimination violates the principle and lacks validity for the conduct of private life. So we got three, and this isn't to say this is everything, right? But we've got the political, we have the private, and then we have society. And they're all governed by their own set sort of, you know, workings or principles. And they work best when they don't try to absorb each other. So she thinks that, as she goes on, in modern life, we don't have that much of the private anymore. It tends to be absorbed by society or by the political. And she might be right about that, you know. But, you know, we also don't want to just have it be the private. I mean, that's sort of the dream, I think, of some people, isn't it, that everyone will just go the hell away and leave them alone and they get to enjoy whatever they're doing with no repercussions. They just want to have their phone and they don't want to think about the supply chain for that or you know, anything along those lines. That does happen, doesn't it? But those are some of the things that she thinks about in terms of what we call her philosophical anthropology. And her notion of politics is really based on the idea of active citizenship, that we ought to be actively engaged. That doesn't mean that we always have to, like, have a, when you come to an election, it's okay to say, I don't really have anybody I like to vote for in this case, but I'm going to, you know, cast a vote anyway. I think she would perfectly understand that sort of thing. But it should be something thoughtful, and it shouldn't just be thinking off by oneself or in what we call one's echo chamber or silo. You guys familiar with this silo concept? Everybody's in their own little silo, and they don't communicate with the silos next to them. We should be, she thinks, engaged with people who are different than us and talking with them and bouncing our ideas off of them, even if they don't fully grasp us or, you know, approve of what we're doing. And we should try to solicit them to do the same with us. That would be what she's calling politics. Do you guys have any questions about that? If not, I'm going to jump right into the totalitarianism and the Holocaust part that I promised I would talk about is the key topic. But this might be something worth lingering over. Well, if you have any questions about that, we'll hit on it again in the end. So let's talk about totalitarianism. When we use that word, I think it's kind of worn out quite a bit in our own time. There are totalitarian states in the present. But, you know, what we call totalitarianism isn't always what scholars have talked about as totalitarianism. And there's a lot of things in the past also that got lumped under totalitarianism. So, for example, Arendt will distinguish very strongly between Nazi Germany, which she says is a totalitarian society, and fascist Italy, which she said was not a totalitarian society. And it wasn't just because the Italians couldn't get it together or, you know, failed in their aims or anything like that. Mussolini was not, for all of the fact that he was a fascist, he was not a totalitarian. The Nazis were. Who else does she think was a totalitarian? The Soviets. The Soviets and the Nazis. And this is what actually got her in a lot of hot water with people on the left. You know, the people on the left loved what she was saying about other stuff, but they hated the fact that she said, well, Stalin, it's not just Stalin's just as bad as Hitler because he killed a lot of people. It was Stalin was, you know, perhaps worse than Hitler because the Soviets went further in making a totalitarian society than the Nazis did. And so, you know, leftists didn't like criticizing the Soviet Union until Mao came along, and then you could be a Maoist leftist and, you know, not like the Marxist revisionism of the Soviets. Now, she thought that, and this is one of the key arguments that she's making in this book, there's actually three main divisions to the origins of totalitarianism. The first one is anti-Semitism. The second one is imperialism. And then the third one is totalitarianism. What she's saying, in part, about the Holocaust is not that it wasn't a horrible thing and that the Jews weren't in fact singled out, but in part the Jews were singled out according to her because they provided a convenient target. And anti-Semitism that was going on, like in pogroms and even the Dreyfus affair, something in her view very different than what happened in Nazi Germany and also happened in Soviet persecution of Jews, too, because a lot of that went on in the Soviet Union, too. So there's that. And then she thought that World War I was the thing that managed to create use the metaphor that got used leading up to the Iraq War, the fever swamp that totalitarianism emerged from. Remember that metaphor, we're going to drain the swamps, right? It didn't work too well. We created new swamps. The irrigation system broke down when it came to that. But World War I so dislocated things in so many different ways that it opened the door to a new way of doing politics, totalitarianism. And she wants to make the case that totalitarianism is different than despotism, which was already a category we had, or even, military dictatorship. There's plenty of military dictators who are terrible people, and they're doing, awful things to their country, but they're not totalitarian, because in order to be totalitarian, there are certain things that have to occur. Let me skip to this. I took a bunch of passages from the origins of totalitarianism, from the third part. She says, totalitarian movements are possible whenever there are masses for one reason or another, have acquired the appetite for political organization. Masses are not held together by a consciousness of common interest, and they lack that specific class articulateness, which is expressed in a determined, limited, and obtainable goals. So when politics becomes utopian, and it can be utopian in the sense of progressive, like she talks about the Soviets, we're talking about history. History is going to prove that we're doing the right thing in, destroying all the other political parties, in, rounding the peasants up and putting them into, farms, in sending people to the gulags. History is going to prove us right. We're on the side of progress, right? So there was that. Or it could be backwards looking, what in fascist studies scholars call palingenesis, looking back to the palin means old, and genesis, the origin, right? The origin, going back to the Aryan people or whoever else it's going to be, right? Because it's not, in the 20th century with the Nazis, it was definitely the Aryans, but there's other forms of that sort of stuff out there that use other origin stories as well. And totalitarianism tries to suck the masses into that and give them meaning as a mass, not as an organized body, but as atomized people. And so certain kinds of societies are ripe for that. Other societies, where maybe civil society is much stronger, even if they're poor, maybe not be ripe for that. She goes on and she says, neither tribal nationalism nor rebellious nihilism is characteristic of or ideologically appropriate to the masses as they were to the mob. It should be mob instead of mod. But the most gifted leaders of our time have still risen from the mob. She distinguishes between the mass and the mob. With the mob, you have essentially people who are, like in a criminal enterprise. They're ready to transgress the rules of society so that they can get what they want. And they recognize force, fraud, and fear as their, hallmarks. That's what gets them what they want. So she says, the mob as leader of these masses was no longer the agent of the bourgeoisie or anyone except the masses. There was a common way of looking at Hitler and the Nazi Party that I think disabled a lot of people in Germany and outside of Germany, where they said, these fascists don't really mean what they're saying. These Nazis don't really mean what they're saying. They're really just about, keeping the bourgeois order there. They're really about capitalism. And it's true, the sort of fat cat capitalists, like the Krupps or people like that, they thought the Nazis were going to be their tools. It didn't turn out like that at all, because the Nazis did in fact believe the stuff that they were saying. And so the mob winds up becoming the leader for the mass. She goes on and she says, only the mob and the elite can be attracted by the momentum of totalitarianism itself. The masses, they have to be won by propaganda. It's not something that you can immediately get them to latch onto. You got to, you know, Hitler had to keep telling the same lie over and over again, and people will believe it, right? You have to constantly drill it into them. And then there's another element, too. And this is leading us to the ultimate sort of conclusion of totalitarianism. She says, propaganda is indeed part and parcel of psychological warfare, but terror is more. Terror continues to be used by totalitarian regimes, even when its psychological aims are achieved. I think she's completely right. This is one way you can tell a totalitarian society. It's not just that they're sadists. It's that there's a sort of inherent logic to totalitarian movements that require a terrorized populace. And how do you terrorize people? Well, you take them away in the middle of the night. You send them off to the camps. Or you get their children to inform on them. There's a lot of different devices. And she says, where the role of terror is brought to perfection, as in concentration camps, propaganda disappears entirely. You don't need propaganda after a certain point, provided you can create terror. And then finally, she says, by pressing men against each other, total terror destroys the space between them. Total terror, the essence of a totalitarian government, exists neither for men nor against men. It is supposed to provide the forces of nature or history with an incomparable instrument to accelerate their movement. So, again, in the case of the Nazis, it was the race, right? And in the case of the Soviets, it was the progress of the proletariat. Those are ideas. And those ideas in totalitarian societies can come to take such power, such shape, that they have, ultimately, they're the ones that have the agency. And sooner or later, nobody's really running the show. It's not even the Führer, you know, or the secretary of the party. Those are the two names, you know. Hitler was the Führer, and Stalin was the secretary of the party. Secretary sounds kind of menial to us, but it wasn't for them. Ultimately, nobody's in charge. And the process just keeps going on, grinding up everybody. That's the way she depicts it. She talks in The Origins of Totalitarianism about radical evil. Is this a term that you guys are familiar with? It's been used, you know, in speeches these days, but I don't think they mean exactly the same thing today when they talk about radical evil. You know, she wrote her dissertation on Augustine. And Augustine, in the Confessions, have any of you read the Confessions at one time or another? When he was a boy, he stole pears from a pear tree. And there's this analysis of the evil of the act of stealing. Now, he didn't steal because he was hungry. He didn't steal for any good reason that he could think of. And he's trying to rack his brains. Like, why the hell did I steal this stuff then? Was it just to, like, you know, get social approval? No, because I don't really care about my friends either. And he ultimately concludes that what made him do it was nothing. There was nothing behind it. This is something that, and Augustine concludes something about human nature from this, that Kant will later on go on to talk about in terms of radical evil. There is a capacity within all of us to do terrible things, and not for the reason that we're motivated by wealth or lust or anything like that. As a matter of fact, she's got a great little line. I'm not going to read the whole passage, but I'll just read this little bit for you from The Origins of Totalitarianism. She says, here we go. When the impossible was made possible, that's what she thinks Nazism did. It became the unpunishable, unforgivable, absolute evil, which could no longer be understood and explained by the evil motives of self-interest, greed, covetousness, resentment, lust for power, and cowardice, and which therefore anger could not revenge, love could not endure, friendship could not forgive. And she says, this is really a problem for us. We always want it to make sense. Why do these evil people do the stuff they do? You know, why do terrorists engage in terrorist activity? Well, it's poverty, or it's the fact that we're bombing. Pretty good reasons, I think, you know, for somebody to in a bad situation say, okay, I think I'm going to do that sort of stuff. But in some cases, there isn't an explanation. And she says, it's inherent in our entire philosophical tradition that we cannot conceive of a radical evil. The problem is, there is radical evil, and we have to confront it. And that's part of what happened in the Nazi regime and part of what happened in Stalinism. I think she also thinks that that also took place in the Cultural Revolution. And I think if she were around, you know, it happened, the records of it are happening after she died, but if she were to look at what happened with the Khmer Rouge in Cambodia and the accounts that we have, she would see that sort of thing going on there. There's a lot of places where this sort of thing can happen. Now, if we turn to Eichmann, what's the phrase that everybody associates with Eichmann?
Banality.
Yeah, the banality of evil. Isn't that like at the exact opposite end from radical evil? Eichmann was, you know, Eichmann tried to present himself as, you know, the bureaucrat who just sort of followed the Führer and had the weird sort of reasoning about how he was, you know, doing his duty and Kant would be able to approve and stuff like that. And she writes about that, and she cuts through all that. And eventually she says, and this is in that passage, when I speak of the banality of evil, I do so on the strictly factual level, pointing at a phenomenon which stared one in the face at the trial. Now notice the people that she says he's not. Eichmann was not Iago, right? In Shakespeare's Othello, Iago is like, I'm going to get that SOB, right? I'm going to steer him. Eichmann wasn't doing that. Eichmann was not Macbeth. He didn't have a Lady Macbeth there to say, hey, ambition, you know, and I want you to do this sort of stuff. Eichmann had, you know, superiors, but he went along with it. And he says, nothing would be further from his mind than to determine with Richard III to prove a villain. There's no, like, I'm going to be evil for the sake of being evil, which Richard III, maybe that's actually going on there. So she says, except for an extraordinary diligence in looking out for his personal advancement, he had no motives at all. Now, he tried to claim, I didn't really hate Jewish people or anything like that. That probably doesn't hold up. And Arendt doesn't buy that at all. But she says, he was not stupid. It was sheer thoughtlessness, something by no means identical with stupidity, that predisposed him to become one of the greatest criminals of this period. And if this is banal and even funny, if with the best will in the world one cannot extract any diabolic or demonic profundity from Eichmann, that's still far from calling it commonplace. It surely cannot be so common that a man facing death, and moreover standing below the gallows, should be able to think of nothing but what he has heard at funerals all his life. He had just cliches. He would just speak in cliches constantly. He was not a guy who would think about what he was doing. And yet he was at the center of all of the logistic apparatus required to, you know, suck all of these Jewish people into the, you know, grinding wheels of a massive machine. And he did it, you know, as efficiently as he could, but he didn't really think about what he was doing. And so do we have to choose between these? Do we have to say, here's where I think a lot of the criticisms of Hannah Arendt are off base. They'll say, yeah, she just, you know, gave Eichmann a pass. She said that, you know, banality of evil, and we could all be like him if we're not thinking. I don't think she's saying that. And do we have to choose when we're thinking about evil and totalitarianism between saying, well, there's banality of evil and there's radical evil. We can't have both of them acting at the same time. Or couldn't they both be sort of functioning together to create even more evil? Yeah.
Is totalitarianism always evil?
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a great question. Arendt would say yes. I mean, I would say yes, too. Mm-hmm. In part because what she sees totalitarianism doing is ultimately making an inhuman landscape where it's not possible for the human to be human. And I don't mean in the biological sense, right? You still have human beings reproducing and laboring, but you see this in totalitarian societies. This is something else that she remarked about. the crimes that end up getting committed. This is why Eichmann was so hard to try. The crimes that end up getting committed, it seems impossible to do justice to them because they go so far beyond the pale. What was being attempted with genocide was to eradicate an entire people from the community of nations, to reduce plurality. And ultimately, the people who were involved with it, I mean, some of them like may have been sadists and they kind of got off on being sadistic. A lot of them weren't. A lot of them, you look at these accounts of the Einsatzgruppen and people out, you know, killing people in Russia. A lot of them hated what they were doing. And yet they're involved with it. And they don't see any way out of it. And pretty soon, there is no truth that you can identify as truth, you could say. And that happened in the Soviet Union, too. You know? And to do that to human beings is to remove from them the very possibility of having anything like what she's calling politics. You know, people actually being different from each other, talking with each other. Maybe I'm kind of full of, you know, crap in some respects, but at least you can call me on that, and I can, like, realize it. And that's part of what it means to, you know, live and grow together, right? Totalitarian society, when it really works, it rules that out. It just becomes totally impossible. And nobody ends up okay in it. You know, you look at what Stalin was like. Mm-hmm. Totally paranoid. By the end, pretty much crazy. Hitler, very similar.
How different is it from democracy?
Oh. Well, it depends a lot on what we call democracy, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Like, if we just mean we all get to vote, democracy can devolve into totalitarianism. Mm-hmm. Especially when it's a young democracy. That's not something I sort of built into the talk about the lecture. I know Arendt talks about this at some point, but I don't know where. And I'm going to use an example from after she died to sort of illustrate this. So when we went into Iraq, there was all this, you know, argument of weapons of mass destruction and Al-Qaeda, you know, sort of the pretext. But there was also something else going on within the Bush regime that a lot of the people outside of the Bush regime could actually get on board with, the democracy agenda. The idea was that by removing a brutal dictator, which Hussein certainly was, in a totalitarian society, which Iraq arguably was, a totalitarian police state, we would create a democracy in the Middle East that then could be used as kind of like a base, you might say, ideologically to promote democracy all over the place. And so Iran could then, you know, what little they have going on in democracy there could be strengthened. And maybe the Saudis, clearly not a democracy, right, could also steer that way. And what we didn't bank on was the fact that you can't install a democracy overnight. What you need are generations of people who buy into democracy as being something good in itself and not just a tool for you to, like, get your group in there, right? And so what happened in Iraq, well, it fell apart. You know? I mean, we made a lot of mistakes, you know, like we didn't take care of the Baathists when we took power. There were cases where some of the militias, we let them stay in place too long. If the Russians had handled it, they would have done it very differently. They probably would have made a mess, too. But because we didn't think it through, now there isn't a functioning democracy in Iraq. Parts of it are in ISIS hands. Iran came in and took large portions. And we did manage to get a bunch of other revolts kicked off in other places. But are those other places better off? Is Egypt or Libya better off? I don't really know. And so, you know, when it comes to democracy, we can't just put one there and then hope that it's going to, like, flourish. And Arendt would say, yeah, of course. You know, you need institutions. You need to be building the political sphere And sometimes you have to transition to democracy over time, which is what happened, you know, in the United States. We had our revolution, and then we were a democracy in a certain extent, but we didn't let everybody vote. It took a long time of expanding the franchise, and that might not be that bad of a thing. I think it is a terrible thing when it comes to, like, say, gender or race, but maybe it wasn't that bad of a thing when it came to class, you know? Maybe the America would have gone a very different way if suddenly everybody was able to vote at the very beginning. So is democracy a good thing? Yes, in principle, but we have to be really careful about how we do it. And, you know, I mean, I'll put this out there as an open question for the group. Mm-hmm. Are we in a democracy now because we get to vote, or are we really in something more like a couple of competing oligarchies? Because I don't feel... I mean, we're in a battleground state here, so clearly our vote does count for something. But I don't feel particularly enfranchised. Like, I have a stake, you know, a seat at the table. And I think about it this way. If I were to get involved in politics here, even in Wisconsin, which is, you know, I may get in trouble saying this. People may not like that, but it's better than being in Illinois, sort of the dirtiness of the politics. You'd have to get your hands so compromised. You'd have to compromise yourself so much and get your hands so dirty to make it up to where you'd actually have some deciding vote that I can't see it as worthwhile myself. But what do you guys think? I don't know. Maybe I'm too pessimistic about that.
Well, there's a lot of different variations on democracy. I mean,
yeah.
You know, a pure democracy, which is direct vote. I guess I'd make
the
rash observation that any pure form isn't going to work.
Yeah, they don't
pure
last.
Socialism doesn't work. Pure democracy doesn't work.
Yeah.
And all kinds. So, you know, we have this representative democracy messy business, and
yeah.
You know, which is real different. You know, I did a lot of work over in places like Sweden and all that, those sorts of places.
Yeah.
And they say, well, we're more democratic than you are. What they're talking about is the direct democracy,
yeah.
Which here we have by way of referendums, okay, which
yeah.
I find a very questionable activity in many cases. Because people don't understand what they're actually voting on.
Well, because it's not usually, there's no referendum about how to write the referendum.
The chicanery that goes on in the phrasing of the referendum is
ridiculous. Yeah.
But, so, you know, I think, you know, when we talk democracy, that's an awfully broad subject.
Yeah.
You know, and to your point, you know, we had this childlike belief that all you got to do is let the Iraqis vote, everything will take care of itself.
Oh, yeah.
And they have centuries of warlords. And if you back the wrong warlord, you're going to get killed if the other guy wins. You know, you don't get... one thing I would say is I've read some extremely good observations on that. I can't remember. The King of Jordan. What's his name?
Oh, the new one. Yeah.
Yeah. He has made great commentary on how you can't go directly from a monarchy to a democracy and, you know, the stages that have to happen.
Yeah, you have to create civil society.
Yeah.
It's not going to work. And it's unfortunate that we really smart people in all these administrations that we have, in the Bush administration, the Obama administration, and they just don't seem to get it, you know? Yeah.
I'm listening yesterday to a piece about how algorithms are really running everything.
And
getting fed news and any information we're looking at certainly through our computers is specifically depersonalized. I mean, Arendt talks about the need for dialogue and the messiness of it, and this just seems antithetical.
Yeah, and how, if you're in your Facebook feed, Facebook is elevating posts that agree with you, mm-hmm. according to sentiment analysis, you know, and it's just going to get more and more sophisticated. We're at the very beginning stage of it. At least that sort of silo or echo chamber effect. When Facebook first came out, I tried to be the person who would, point out to both sides, hey, there's more to the issue than this. I don't know if any of you did that, but it didn't go very well for me at all. Both sides ended up hating my guts. I think Arendt, the same thing happened to her. You know? Yeah.
Getting back to evil, I'm talking about banal evil and radical evil. I mean, wouldn't she also admit that there's a segment of, I'll call it, coerced evil?
Yeah.
She would, right?
Yeah,
because,
yeah.
You know, you're being instructed to do this, you hate it, but you're in fear for your life, and so you do it.
Threaten your family, or you've got to weigh off these difficult...
As opposed to just thoughtlessness.
Yeah, and I, you know, when I was thinking about how I should set this up, I was thinking, well, okay, we've got radical evil where it's like, look, this doesn't make any sense. Why the hell is this person behaving that way? And then we've got the banal evil, which also, in a certain sense, it's inexplicable too. And then we've got what we might call ordinary evil, right? It's still evil. And you know that the person did it, they killed the person for the insurance money because they like having money, you know? And you're like, well, that's wrong. And, well, yeah, we get that. And people make bad choices like that. So, you know, think about what some of the people in the Holocaust were. Well, you know, here's something I didn't bring up from Eichmann in Jerusalem. Something that got Arendt in a lot of trouble with other Jewish authors is she pointed out the fact that the Holocaust could not have happened in the numbers that it did without quite a lot of Jewish cooperation. The Nazis put Jewish authorities in power, and they also had Jews working within the camps themselves to like police things. And now think about those guys who are in that sort of situation. Do you do stuff that you know is leading to people getting abused and killed because you say, well, by doing this amount of evil, I can prevent a greater amount of evil from happening? Because that turned out to be one of the hooks that they could use to get people with these councils. The councils thought that they were like saving the people by sacrificing a few. And the Nazis, you know, they exploited that. And so, you know, that's not banal evil, because they're not like, oh, I don't know what I'm doing, you know, it's just dotting the I's, you know. And it's certainly not radical evil. We can understand it. We could be in that situation, you know. And there's a lot of that. You could say one of the bad things about a totalitarian society is it multiplies that, and it makes it impossible to say, okay, enough of that. We won't do that anymore. Whereas in a democratic society, we can sometimes opt out.
Does it come to the individual? And my thought is this, that I hear very many people who say, I'm poor, that's why I steal. And there are other poor people who wouldn't even think of doing that, but would share. So what happens there? I mean, to society then?
We don't have to be in a totalitarian society for people to end up... on the one hand, being in conditions which make it a lot harder for them to behave like, you know, in a humane way to other people. And on the other hand, for there to be plenty of gaps where people like just slip in and say, well, I know I should behave humanely, but I'm taking the stuff anyway. And being poor is a rationalization for that. We don't have to have a totalitarian society for that to be the case. Every society has stuff like that going on. And it's a perennial issue that we have to face up to. We can never not have something like a system of justice, however imperfect, functioning, right? And usually that's not enough. We need other things like social coercion. This is where actually Arendt, you know, I'm actually going to read you a passage that I marked and was hoping I would get to. She talks about the need for authority. And she says that we live in a time where authority in the 20th century essentially broke down. A lot of people are distrustful of it. And she says, since authority always demands obedience, it's commonly mistaken for some form of power or violence. But authority is something different. She says it precludes the use of external means of coercion. Where force is used, authority itself has failed. But authority, on the other hand, is incompatible with persuasion, which presupposes equality and works through a process of argumentation. Where arguments are used, authority is left in abeyance. And so she says that authority is always hierarchical, but we find ourselves in the hierarchy. So if you're like my boss, and you say, look, I need you to go do this, and, you know, I start stealing things, you know, they call shrinkage in the retail industry, right? So you take it out the back door. There's something going on there that could, in fact, be addressed by what she's calling authority, but the problem is so much authority to us now seems irrational, broken down. Who the hell are you to tell me what to do, you know? Well, I'm your boss. Well, what does that mean? We're all the same, aren't we? Well, if we do that, society doesn't function for very well. It's sort of like the direct democracy thing, right? Mm-hmm. On the other hand, we don't want it just to be, well, I'm the boss, so you're going to do what I say, or I'm like, can you, or using force. If there isn't any sort of respect for something, and again, this has to do with like a humane existence. Humans can live together when we recognize some shared norms. If we don't have anything like that, we're screwed. And then that's why totalitarianism can appear attractive, because the totalitarians come along and they're like, hey, all these you know, class conflicts, all these, you know, racial conflicts, I can resolve those. You know, I'll be in charge. I'll settle this for you. And that's usually where it takes its root. There's something else I was going to sort of leave you with in terms of Arendt. So I'll tell you this story, and then we can discuss it. Or I don't want to take too much of your time tonight, but I'm happy to stick around for any questions. Kafka has a parable, Franz Kafka, who, by the way, Arendt was instrumental in when she was an editor in getting his stuff actually published over here. So she really liked Kafka a lot. Kafka tells a story about this guy who's stuck in between two other people who are fighting. And they're both pushing him, and they both want him to fight the other guy. So on this, to his back, he's got somebody pushing him forward. And in his front, he's got somebody pushing him back. And he's in a quandary, because he's got to fight both of them at once at the same time, right? That's hard to do. It makes his life miserable. And what his greatest desire is that he could just step back and let these two idiots fight each other, because the whole reason why they're pushing him is because they want to get at each other. Let them fight it out, and he can be the umpire based on his experience with fighting. He can say, well, this one's fighting better, this one's fighting better. So what are these? The guy in the middle is the present, the human being in the present moment. And the two things fighting against each other through him as a proxy are the past and the future. And wouldn't it be nice if we could just get out of the way and let these two morons duke it out themselves? But we can't. We're stuck here in the middle, turning towards one, turning towards the other, never truly being able to, you know, get ourselves grounded and give the knockout blow to this one or to that one. That's the human condition, according to Arendt, in terms of time. Yeah.
Back to that totalitarian movement.
Yeah.
Is anybody implying, what she's saying about that too with the Islamic God, where, you know, people are saying, oh, they can't really mean that's true America.
Yeah.
Anybody...
So there are, and are you asking if there are people actually applying Arendt herself? Mm-hmm. There are some people, and she was, you know, she was moving in circles of people who do in fact talk about this. Like Norman Podhoretz has a piece on Eichmann in Jerusalem, sort of responding to her. He's the one who talks about the Third World War, or the Fourth World War, the one against Islamic. I forget exactly what phrase he uses. I do think that when it comes to, say, Wahhabism, right, not Islam as a whole, but when it comes to that sort of stuff, it looks very similar to totalitarianism as it got developed under the Nazis and under the Soviets, and you know, when the Chinese were doing that as well. But it's, in some respects, harder to combat, because instead of like going back like the Nazis did to some mythological Aryan race, you know, and having essentially a 12-year Reich, to talk about, or the Soviet Union having this, you know, wonderful workers' paradise off in the future, they can look back over 1,400 years of history. Now, a lot of that has to be sanitized. They have to get rid of a lot. And this is what happens. You know, Wahhabism is, in some respects, anti-historical Islamic, because anybody who disagrees with them, they take them out of the picture. In the present, they take them out of the picture as well. But it's got a lot of staying power. And it does offer a sort of totalistic view of the universe. And I think that in what's going on, you can see a similar attitude towards terror and death on the part of the people calling the shots and the people who are engaging in a lot of the fighting. I would also say that you can see something kind of similar in the Mexican cartels, some of the just sheer evil stuff that's engaged in just across the border, sometimes on the side of the border. Somewhere something morphed into something, you know, where radical evil really does take place. And there is also the banal side of it, you know. ISIS can only work because the oil flows and because somebody keeps track of the accounts and somebody makes sure that the video feed goes out and all that. And there's probably some guy who's like, I just do that job. I'm not really involved in the other stuff. So I would say that what she's saying is really relevant to that. I don't want to say that's the only or main thing that it's relevant to, but it is, you know, yeah, it's going to be one of the huge world historical challenges of our time. So, yeah. Any other questions or comments or? Yeah.
Do you think that she really believes some of these things, or she's trying to take a stand that's so out there to get the reaction?
I think she believes them because she provides explanation and argument for, in the other parts of the works, for all the things that she says. And that's a really good question.
He had no motives at all.
Say again?
That he had no motives at all.
No, she said besides the motive that he had, which is essentially just promoting his career.
That's all it was for him.
I mean, she does think that's the case in Eichmann and Jerusalem. Yeah, she makes that argument.
No way criminal.
Say again?
In no way criminal.
Oh, no, she didn't say that.
The diligence was in no way criminal.
Yeah, the diligence. That doesn't mean everything about him is in no way criminal. He's on trial.
No motives. Like, he had none of the Nazi motives of...
The diligence is looking out for his personal advancement. That diligence itself, she's saying, is not criminal. She's not saying his acts aren't criminal.
But that was, he had no motives other than his personal advancement. He
That's the way she read him, yeah.
She wasn't interested in, promoting the masteries. And
he doesn't appear to have...
He just wanted to do his job.
Well, he didn't just want to do his job. He wanted
to do it well.
Yeah, he wanted to be recognized for it too, and he did get, like, he was very petty when he didn't get recognized properly. And the reason why we know so much about Eichmann is because he was willing to just talk for hours. You know, weird. Can you imagine that? Just like, you know, spilling your guts. And there were like certain places. The way Arendt looks at it, there's certain places where like a normal person, after saying the sorts of things that he's saying, would go, holy crap, what's wrong with me, right? And nothing like that ever happened with Eichmann. He made a couple, you know, arguments about his conscience and having to overcome that, but she thinks that a lot of that was just sort of window dressing, you know?
He always struck me like the type of sociopath that's fairly normal except for absolutely lacking in any empathy at all. No feeling for other people.
He did have empathy for... This does go to the thing. He didn't have empathy for Jews. That's really clear. He didn't like to be there when people were getting killed. So it's not like he was a cool customer. But that was more about, like, you know, just not bodily existence. And he could be empathetic when it came to, like, his family or people like that. And there was kind of like a... But it wasn't like he was just an anti-Semite, so he got into the Nazi party because... there were a lot of people who were. They just wanted to stick to the Jews, right? He got into the Nazi Party, and he was climbing the ranks. And well, the Jews happened to be the people to do this to. Okay, they're not my problem as people.
Attention, patrons. The library will be closing in about 30 minutes. If you need a library card, yeah, please go to the circulation desk to apply for it now.
I don't think she was letting him off the hook anyway. I mean, she thought that he should be punished. Like, I mean, it was like, this is what she saw. And in a way, I feel like it's a cautionary tale of when we think of people who do bad things, we consider them to be monsters. We have to kind of dehumanize them and make them more evil, because only evil people could do these things. And I think what Eichmann shows is you could just be kind of the cog in the wheel, and that's no better or worse. It's still evil.
Yeah, I mean, in a way, he almost, and then I think this goes to that question, Mom, he almost had to be like deliberately obtuse to just be a cog in the wheel.
He wasn't.
That way.
He wasn't obtuse.
In what way?
Do you think so? If you read, I mean, he was too.
You mean if you read
bright,
the transcripts of the stuff
to
that he
be obtuse?
There's a lot of really smart people who managed to be obtuse. That's like what she was saying. He was thoughtless. He wasn't stupid. He just didn't think about these things.
Was it possibly just the otherness? I remember reading an interview with a mob hitman.
Yeah.
This guy was a career murderer. Okay, and it never bothered him because he didn't know those people.
Oh,
he loved his family, loyal to his friends, but he didn't know those people. So he'd just shoot them. You know, so it's like a crazy pathological form of tribalism where, well, they're not part of me, so I'll just shoot them. Or,
yeah.
You know,
when I was
like
years ago, I came across a good, the actual article, and I think it's in Business Ethics Quarterly. There was somebody who was talking about teaching business ethics and using Eichmann of Jerusalem. You know, in business ethics, sometimes read some Aristotle, right? Or we'll read some of this. And this guy was saying, Eichmann in Jerusalem should be one of the texts that gets read for business ethics, because there's so many other cases where somebody's like, yeah, I mean, I just did my job and the water supply got poisoned. I don't, you know, really understand how. Well, I do understand how that happened, but it just, these things, you know, it's too bad. And then they're gone, right? And you, what the hell's wrong with you? Don't you get that people have to drink this water? You know, and
but then they're thinking about it. They're skewed.
Right. So they're
thinking, but she's saying he's not even thinking about it. That I don't believe.
So there's two kinds of thinking. That's probably what's tripping you up. There's thinking about it as like solving a problem. And then there's stepping aside and doing what we might call reflective thinking and saying, wow, in solving this problem, I just sent a whole bunch of people to the camps. By solving the problem of how to coordinate all these train schedules, I'm killing a whole bunch of human beings. So one kind of thinking happens, but another kind doesn't. So like in business ethics, it might be, yeah, I need to figure out how to like maximize shareholder value in this, and just so happens that means poisoning somebody's water supply, but I don't think about this part. So she's not saying that he's thoughtless, like he doesn't think at all. He's thoughtless in the sense that he doesn't step back and do the second order thinking that most human beings would sooner or later do, you know, I would hope. I mean, yeah.
Is that why you think that most of the concentration camps were in Poland and not in Germany?
Oh, so they didn't have to see them? Yeah. There was that, and there was also the fact that they were getting a lot of these Jews in Poland and in the occupied territories of Russia, too. In the East, you could do whatever you wanted, too. In Germany, there was still sort of a legal structure in place, but in the East, it was like anything goes. Yeah.
Going back to your earlier point, isn't it kind of part of totalitarianism to have this huge bureaucracy, to have all these little pieces so that people aren't thinking about the big picture, they're just thinking about what I have to do next, like, and they're not stepping away and thinking about what will this mean, they're just doing their job.
Yeah.
They're connecting A to B to C, and so you can kind of take that reflectiveness away from them.
I think there's that. You know, you don't want people thinking too much, but in order to accomplish the sorts of monumental tasks that totalitarian societies set for themselves, you also do need that sort of level of organization and standardization. She says something else that's really interesting in the origins of totalitarianism that I'm not sure what to make of. She says that it can't really work in small countries. I don't really buy this, but she says it only works well when you get a sizable mass of people, and that would be sort of along the lines of what you're talking about. So nobody can really see what's going on. And that's part of why the Germans were not as successful with it in being totalitarian as the Russians were, because the Germans had this amount of people, even after they absorbed, parts by expanding the Reich. Compare that to the Russians and what they had, a much larger population and longer time, they were able to bring it off more successfully. And that actually, it reminds me too, there's, I forget which fascist studies scholar is out there, somebody said that we're off base in the examples that we use for thinking about the true logic of fascism. Italy was, Italy barely did anything. Spain wasn't even a fascist, it was just a military dictatorship. Mm-hmm. The Nazis, 12 years, and they did a lot of horrible stuff, but they didn't completely bring it off. You want to see where fascism really was successful? Soviet Russia, Communist China, North Korea, and a few other places is what this scholar was saying, where it could really be, nobody knew what was going on. Even the guy in charge. I think there's something inherent to that. Keeping, when you don't want people looking too closely, and that works too in criminal enterprises, and that works in bureaucracies in general. Just keep your head down. Don't make any waves. That places them kind of at risk for being sucked into something like a totalitarian society, I would say. I don't want to hold you guys too much longer, so we're supposed to be done before. Any other questions or comments? Well, thanks very much for your time and great questions. And
thank you.
Happy to share this. And like I said, we'll be doing Plato, Boethius, Thomas Hobbes, Friedrich Nietzsche.
When will you start?
Next year.
Next year?
Next February, yeah.